Praise God. I appreciate so much the emphasis this morning because, what Christmas has become is one thing, but it really is about the sacrifice. It really is about why he came. And I appreciate that. It's tradition to have some sort of a Christmas message. And in the normal sense, that's not what's on my mind and my heart this morning, but there is a connection. And I believe it has to do with the sacrifice. And I'd like to turn to a passage that we've used from time to time and referred to. It's an incident in the life of Abraham. It may sound like it's way out in left field compared to where we're going, but I don't believe it is. And I'm more interested in what's relevant to our lives today anyway than just fulfilling tradition. And I think that's what we need is, I believe God's people always need encouragement and help. And it's always in order. So anyway, Abraham was called Abram at this time, and you remember how God had revealed himself to Abram sometime before this. I don't remember the time element exactly. He was living as basically a heathen, the idol-worshipping family living in somewhere in what is present-day Iraq, probably. And God revealed himself to Abram. Now there was a certain amount of knowledge that had been handed down in a more traditional sense. People knew that there was a God. They had heard the tales of the flood. It wasn't that many centuries after. But I'm sorry, I'm not reading yet. I'm going to go to Genesis chapter 15. I'm not there yet. But anyway, he had heard God's voice, and God said, "Get you out of your family, out of your household, and go to a land I'll show you." And so he began the journey, and actually his dad went with him, and one of his nephews, Lot, went with him, and they settled in a place that was sort of halfway around the Fertile Crescent, and lived there until his father died, and the Lord renewed the call, and they went on to the land, the promised land in Palestine. And he began to be a God worshiper rather than an idol worshiper. Everywhere he went, he built an altar and worshiped God. And there was a sense of faith and confidence that was born in him that has become the model for faith ever since. It's what it's really all about. God spoke, he believed him. I mean, it really is complicated, isn't it? But that's what it comes down to. When God speaks, do we really believe him? And Abram did. And he began to learn about God through his experiences, which again is a pattern for how God deals with his people in the world. We don't sit in a classroom and get it all. We learn in the classroom of life, and we learn over a lot of time and a lot of hard knocks. And so he did. He had the experience of going down into Egypt to escape a drought, I guess, a famine. And lived there for a while, and actually had to sort of tell a half truth to get out of his out of a situation where he knew Pharaoh would take an interest in his beautiful wife, and the Lord even backed him up in that. Isn't it amazing how merciful God is to deal with us where we're at? He accepts us and loves us in one sense, but he doesn't love us, and he loves us too much to leave us there. So he's always reaching down to the very point where we're at, loving us but calling us forward. And he was doing this with Abram. And at every point in his life, Abram was learning more things about God, and his faith was deepening. And you remember how they came to the place where Lot and Abram couldn't take care of their herds and flocks. There was just too many for them to stay together. And so Abram tells Lot, if you go to the left, I'll go to the right, and so forth. Wherever you want to go, you take the first choice. He looked down at that time, the whole plain of Jordan, in what later became pretty much desert after God judged Sodom and Gomorrah. But at that time, it was a beautiful, well-watered place, and so he decided, that's the place I want to go. And so he pitched his tent near Sodom, which was a wicked place. And Abraham continued to worship God. He traveled from place to place, lived in tents. And everywhere he went, he built an altar to God, and God kept revealing himself a little bit at a time. And part of it had to do with his, I'll skip over some of this because it's not important, but anyway, he comes down to this period of time, this incident in chapter 15, where God comes to him in a vision and says, "Do not be afraid, Abram. I am your shield, your very great reward." And there was this sense, you know, Abram was just a household, a pretty good sized household, but nonetheless, he was just an individual with an entourage of servants and flocks and herds, but he was living in as a foreigner in a country. And it was dangerous. In fact, they had just come through that battle of all the kings where he and God helped him to go and rescue, even the king of Sodom, rescued him. It was a blessing to him, even in his condition. And here the Lord reminds him, "Lord, you're here because I brought you here. I'm the one who's protecting you." Isn't that an awesome thing that God, it's this blessing of Abraham, all these blessings of Abraham have passed down to all of his children, and we're his children. If our faith is in Christ, if God has birthed us into his kingdom through what he's done, through the gospel of Jesus Christ and what he's done, we are Abraham's children. We're heirs of these same promises, and God has, you know, whatever he may allow in our lives, he's nonetheless watching over us. There's nothing that Satan can possibly do to any individual life that God does not allow and does not have a purpose in. So praise God. And our reward, I mean, do you want a better reward than to know him and to enjoy his presence? Praise God. I appreciate his presence in our singing this morning. Thank God for the reality of it. It's not just Christmas carols that we sing because we want to feel warm and fuzzy. There's a reality behind those songs. It's the truth. He is the Lord. And he does reign. I know it doesn't look like it because he's permitting things to happen. But he's allowing them to come to a conclusion of the conclusion of the age. We're going to see evil come to a zenith. We're going to see God's people brought to maturity, to a readiness to step over into eternity. How all that's going to unfold, I don't know. But I know who does know. And we, like Abraham, are sojourners in a land that is not our home. That's our home. My home is somewhere else. But I'll tell you, the same God who was with Abram is with us. Praise God. But now Abram, of course, at this point in his life, he's heard what God has said. He's obeyed him. He's believed him. But naturally, he's got questions. You know, I'm going to bless all the world through your seed. Okay, I don't have a son here, and time goes by, and I'm getting old, and things are, how's this going to happen, Lord? So he asked the question. He says, "Oh, sovereign Lord, what can you give me since I remain childless, and the one who will inherit my estate is Eliezer of Damascus?" And that was evidently the custom of the time, that the head of his servants would have become his heir in the absence of a natural heir. And Abraham said, "You have given me no children, so a servant of my household will be my heir." Then the word of the Lord came to him, "This man will not be your heir, but a son coming from your own body will be your heir." He took him outside and said, "Look up at the heavens and count the stars, if indeed you can count them." Then he said to him, "So shall your offspring be." And this is one of really the key verses in the scriptures. It's referred to in the New Testament as the essence of what faith really is and how people become righteous in God's eyes. We certainly cannot earn it. We don't have the ability. We don't have it within us to be able to qualify ourselves to be accepted by God. Ain't going to happen. We're sinners. We need a Savior. But anyway, the Scripture simply says, Abraham believed the Lord, and he, the Lord, credited it to him, Abram, as righteousness. And that ought to be a lesson to us today. That's what God is looking for. He's looking for the simplicity of childlike faith in his ability to save us. I understand your service last Sunday, had to do with we have all we need in Christ. Well, praise God, that's exactly right. Because I don't bring anything to the table when it comes to salvation. God doesn't look down and say, "Hey, there's Phil, I see something good in him, and I'm going to fan it into flame." No, there ain't none, to put it, you know, in good English. There's nothing. I have nothing. He chose. I mean, there's no goodness in me. The goodness is in him. And because of goodness in him, and because of his love and his purpose, He reached down to a helpless sinner and has provided in that Savior everything I could possibly need. I can't add to that. And so salvation is not trying to be a Christian and trying to somehow take on a religious lifestyle, trying to earn my way into His favor. He has given me that in Him. It is abandoning my efforts. It is placing the impossibility of my becoming acceptable to Him into His hands to fix, because I can't do it. But that's the hope of the gospel. And that's what Abram was looking at here. There was no way he could produce an heir. And yet that was central to the very purpose of God for his existence. And yet he looked in the, he stared that impossibility in the face and said, God, I believe you. That's the essence of how we come to God. At some point, God has to confront the human will with the reality of our situation and turn our attention from us and our what we are and what we aren't to Him and to His provision for us. And then our entire trust is placed in that. And then He goes to work. How many people has He gone to work on this week? Yeah, he's still working, isn't he? But thank God He is, because I'm not there yet. Neither are you. But He is faithful. And I'll tell you what, this was a man that God called from such a heathen background, and yet we see that somehow there was something imparted into his spirit that enabled him to have to take a stand in faith, and at every point in his life, even when that faith was severely tried, he was able to stand and push through in spite of wobbles at times, in spite of times when he went this way and that way. God just, there was still something in his heart that continued to point to true north. And he was able to get back on track, and God was able to work. I'll tell you, we have a God who's able to keep us on track when we don't do so good. Thank God. But anyway, the promise was that you're going to have a son, and Abraham believed the Lord, and he credited it to him as righteousness. But here's another thing. Abraham was still, he believed, and yet there was a desire to go deeper. There was a desire to have a stronger conviction. There was a desire to reach further, to climb higher, spiritually speaking. And so he asked the Lord. So this is interesting that this is precipitated by what he says. The Lord continues to go on. He says, I am the Lord who brought you out of Ur of the Chaldeans in Iraq to give you this land to take possession of it. But Abraham said, O sovereign Lord, how can I know that I will gain possession of it? There's still that element of, you know, I believe you, but I'm still, I want to grow in my faith. How many here need to grow in your faith? Yeah, definitely, both hands. But, you know, I believe the Lord knew this was coming. Don't you? He knows everything. And he knew, he could see the heart that was behind this. This wasn't somebody who was looking for reasons to doubt. This wasn't for some carnal thing, but this was somebody who wanted to believe. This was somebody who wanted to trust God, was looking to him with an honest heart. And so he asked the question, how can I know that I will gain possession of it? So the Lord basically sets up a kind of a covenant. I don't know all the what's behind all of this, but it must have been something that was understandable to him. This is how we make a covenant with a deity. You know, the heathens practiced various forms of sacrifice. And so the Lord proposed I was going to call it a ceremony, that's not exactly it, but a covenant event. The Lord said to him, bring me a heifer, a goat, and a ram, each 3 years old, along with a dove and a young pigeon. Abram brought all those to him, cut them in two, and arranged the halves opposite each other. So he's laying out this sacrifice. Now here's what happens while he's doing this and while he's waiting. It said the birds, however, he did not cut in half. But now some other birds come into the picture. Then birds of prey came down on the carcasses, but Abram drove them away. As the sun was setting, Abram fell into a deep sleep, and a thick and dreadful darkness came over him. Then the Lord said to him, know for certain that your descendants will be strangers in a country not their own, and they will be enslaved and mistreated 400 years, but I will punish the nation, and so forth. I'm not going to go ahead and read all of that, but there are great promises. He is given a whole lot more detail about what the Lord's going to be doing for him, and it's something that, it's an experience that was meant to strengthen his confidence and strengthen his faith. God was answering. But what brought my attention back to this was the process. Because here's Abram, at God's behest, setting up a situation where he has now made a sacrifice. He's waiting on God. And what happens? Birds come, don't they? And that's kind of the thought that I had. The birds will come. How many of you had some birds coming around you this week? Yeah. You know, I'll go back to just some basic stuff here. God created us as in his image, and it's something we brought up many times. His purpose was to live in us and through us and to express his wonderful, awesome, divine nature through us. That's what we were made for. We were not made to be independent and rebellious. We were made to be an expression of his life and nature. But we're not the only ones in the scene, are we? We live in a world that is ruled over by spirits of darkness. And these birds are a pretty good picture of those, of devils, really, is what he's talking about here. They're devils. And you think about the nature of a devil and their place in the scheme of things right here. You remember how when God came to Adam and Eve after they had fallen, and he looked at the serpent, and he said, "Dust shall be the serpent's meat." What were we made of in the beginning? Dust. Yeah. What you're talking about there is Satan. This is going to be your existence. Your nature is evil. Your nature is to do everything that is totally contrary to my nature. But the nearest thing you're going to ever have to satisfaction is when you use a human being and you express the evil of your nature through that human being. And you see that in many places in the scripture. You see devils feeding on human beings and trying to express their nature. You'll see someone who's overtaken with wrath, for example. And I'll tell you, that can get to a certain point where there is a demon who he's just like an alcoholic. He can't get away from... He's not happy unless he's expressing what it's his nature to do. So he's got to find somebody and he's got to vent that awful anger that he really has against God. And so he will cultivate and build himself a home in somebody. And you take every aspect of fallen human nature and you will find demons that will feed on that and try to gain control and influence to the point where they can express their nature. And that's the nearest thing they get to pleasure. And they are as addicted to that as the worst drug addict on this planet is addicted to his need for those drugs. And so, what I'm seeing in here is a picture of a believer who has come to God and saying, "God, I give you myself. These birds, this sacrifice represented him. This is me laying down my life. This is me saying, God, I don't belong to the world, I don't belong to the devil, I belong to you, and I am willing to die, I'm willing to lay down my life in order to come to a deeper relationship with you." And how many times have you and I gone out of a service and somehow the Lord has spoken to us? And we've gone out and we've been stirred. We've got a glimpse of something. We've got a glimpse maybe of higher ground, and we begin to reach out for it. And there's something that stirs within us. And what happens? The birds start to come. There's a time element between the time when Abram put out all these birds and he had to sit back and God hadn't come yet. And it's in that interval. I'll tell you, God is wise in the way he does things. He doesn't just, he's not a push-button God. Hey, here's the formula. Oh, good, I'll push that button and boom, I get the instant result. God tries faith, doesn't he? And I'll tell you, if you and I are going to declare, "I'm yours, Lord, I'm going to serve you, I want you, I want higher ground," get ready, devils are going to come. Birds are going to come. And we're going to have to learn to recognize that. And the thing that blesses me is Abram at this point, there was a constancy, there was a certainty, there was a conviction in his heart that this is what I'm doing. The God of the universe told me to do this. This sacrifice is not for you, birds. This sacrifice is for him. And there is, I'll tell you, this is the essence of our Christian journey. You could look at this and say, well, this is a pretty good picture of Abram's entire relationship with God. Because how many times were there when his faith, waiting on the promise of God, 25 years before he even had a son that God could say, yeah, that's the one. And then later on being asked to sacrifice that one son. All these things that God called him to do that represented sacrifices of his own heart and his own nature, laying down his life for the purpose of God that to which God had called him. And how many? Can you imagine the things that went through his head during that time? Yeah. Oh, I started to try to organize this, and like so often, it just doesn't seem like I'm able to, or the Lord blesses me to do that, and it's probably a good thing. Because you don't need my sermon. But I'll tell you what, there are birds that will attack every single person. One of them is, you did all this and nothing's happening. You prayed this prayer and nothing's happening. You know why? Something's wrong with you. Gotten quiet here. Yeah. How many of you have had that kind of bird land on your head at a time like that? Yeah, that's just situation normal. But I'll tell you what, God is going to teach us every time he allows a bird to come. God is teaching us something. God is teaching us to make a choice, and we talked about that Wednesday night. Every time we have some idea that comes into our heads that is contrary to what God has promised, what God has said, there's like a fork in the road. We come to a fork, and God says, this is the way, walk ye in it. The devil comes along and says, time's wasted, you're wasting your time. You tried it, it didn't work. Give in. And we have a choice, don't we? I'll tell you what, God is so wise in the way he does things. He tries faith not to discourage us, but to build strength. Because you look at Abram after this was all over. Abraham, do you think his confidence increased? I do. Because I'll tell you what, he was able to withstand every attack of every single bird that came along, and he was able to look the devil in the eye and say, get away. This sacrifice I have offered myself. This represents me. I have offered myself to God. You can't have me. I'm not yours anymore. You can't come to me with this doubtful thought. God's promise doesn't apply to me. How many devils have come into your mind and your heart and your life and tried to be the fine print devil? This wonderful scripture, but the devil comes along, there must be some fine print or something would be happening that's different. You would feel different. Circumstances would arrange themselves differently. God would deal you with, if you really give yourself to God, it's going to work out this way. And so the fine print devil comes along and says, there's some fine print in this that you're not getting. This is a wonderful promise, but it doesn't apply to you because there's something about you that disqualifies you. There is not a person alive to whom that wouldn't have some fine print disqualify us if it depended on us. Thank God the gospel does not depend upon, as I said, some goodness in me. It depends upon just surrendering and believing in what he is able to do. That's what Abram was called to do. I surrender this problem of not having a child and going years and getting old and all these things. It's impossible, God. But I believe you anyway. And the devils are going to come because here you are delaying coming and meeting me with this sacrifice. You told me to be here, Lord, and now you're not here. And here I am, and the birds are bothering what I have laid out. What's wrong? Nothing was wrong. God was allowing Abram to go through something that was, that gave him choices, but as he made the right choices, his faith was getting stronger. Do you know when you and I have to battle, have to fight the good fight of the faith, as Paul says, do you know it makes us stronger? Do you know if we didn't go through that way, if we didn't come that way, we would just be weak and spoiled Christians. I'll tell you, we are going to have to win the prizes of the kingdom of God in battle. And that means a steadfastness of heart and spirit that says, Lord, I am yours. What you have given to me does not belong to a devil to come and express the evils of his nature through me. He is not going to come. The bird of fear is not going to come and take over my life. Because fear is just a form of unbelief. You have given me the power over that. I have the right to beat that bird off and say, God, I'm trusting you. Get away from me, devil. It could be some form of sin and self-indulgence. Where there's a devil that comes and says, he's not coming. You might just as well give in to this. You might as well indulge yourself. You might as well. And he works together with the bird of self-pity and discouragement. Boy, they gang up on you sometimes, and you're just going to give in to that and say, well, there's no use. I'm heading down a road that's not going to lead me anywhere. The Lord said he was going to come, and here I am sitting there trying to keep birds off of the very sacrifice he told me to make. This is fruitless. I bet a lot of us have experienced some of those birds, haven't you? I'll tell you what. May God give us the grace to understand his ways to the point where we can trust him, where we understand that faith does not have a time limit on it. We either believe or we don't believe. Believing isn't, I'm going to believe, I'm going to believe, I'm going to believe until it just doesn't seem like it's going to happen. And, oh, well. Faith just simply says, God, I trust you. My times are in your hands. You're the one who knows when it's time to come and accept this sacrifice and reveal yourself to me and complete this transaction that's going on here. God, I have set my heart to serve you. I am trusting in you. I'm not bailing on this situation. Praise God. Am I the only one that's ever experienced these things? I don't think so. I've had several birds come this week. Have you? Yeah. And they, you know, we have birds of busyness that just kind of get us involved and distracted. And you start getting all of those birds. I can just see Abram getting so involved with beating the birds off that he's forgotten all about why he's there. You ever been there? Yeah. Praise God. God give us somehow in these experiences the ability to look beyond the moment, to not get buried in what's coming into our heads and the circumstances that surround us, not to get so lost in those things that we forget why we're here and who we are and the God that we serve. God is looking to build a constancy in us that will not be turned aside no matter which bird comes and says, hey, that part of you belongs to me. Devil, that part of you does not belong to you. It belongs to him. And I don't care if he takes 5 minutes or 10 years for things to happen the way I think they ought to happen. I'm yours, Lord. I'm yours. I believe you. I believe in the process. I believe in your power to rescue me from my sins. I believe in your power to save me. I believe in your power to bring me to higher ground. Because the birds will come, won't they? You know, I don't know how long to go on with this. It may be one of these services where we have others that want to participate. But I'll tell you what. I don't know why I've thought about this, but I just, you know, I was thinking about, my mind tends to go to teaching subjects, and I don't know, I just, something about the way I was thinking just turned my mind and said, no, Lord, the people need encouragement. The people need something. We're being pressed. This is a season that does tend to occupy you and make you feel busy and pressed, and there's almost an oppression in the air sometimes if we're not careful. And I don't want to get so lost in that that I forget who I am and why we're here. I want to stay in a place where, Lord, I belong to you, live, drown, sink, swim, whatever it is. I'm in your hands, Lord. I believe the promises that you've given to me. I believe that they're going to happen the way you want them to happen. I believe they're going to happen when you want them to happen. But oh, I would love to be able to find that springboard in Egypt and jump all the way to Canaan, but it ain't going to happen like that. I've got to go through some things because I've got to learn something about God and about his ways. And the only way I learn them is having to stand against the opposition. And here it was birds that said, this part of you belongs to me. Oh, I'll tell you, there's a lot of birds that come to our lives. Sometimes they've really set up a home in our lives. We've listened, we've given in to him too much. I'll tell you, there's a God who can deliver us. There's a God who can deliver us from the birds that have even made a nest in our homes, in our hearts, if we just turn our hearts to God. But I'll tell you, how many of you know that when you start to take a stand against something, do the birds just abandon? Oh, they gang up, don't they? They come with a flock. But thank God that he that's within us, he that's in us is greater than he that's in the world. We've got somebody, you know, I love what Carl said the other day about that devil that tried to come and oppress him and then whisper in his ear, I'm back. And what he said to the effect was, well, the Lord's here and he never left. Praise God. That's exactly right. Boy, we need a conviction that's going to enable us not to be dismayed. If you're looking for a way to serve God that's free of birds, good luck. There's no such thing. If we are going to serve God, the devil will be his target. And I'll tell you, as God's people have come to the end of the age, we will be targeted by the devil in greater and greater ways. But we're going to have to learn that it's not in us to stand. It's not in us to serve God. We are dependent upon him, but he is up to the job. Because he's promised never to leave us, never to forsake us. Praise God, I need him. Boy, I need him. And sometimes when I get conscious, oops, I've been listening to that bird again. He keeps talking to me and I keep listening and my mind gets off on him and I'm down here and I'm feeling sorry for myself or whatever, and Lord help me. Devil, get out of here. I praise God, Lord. Sometimes we need to be able to thank God for things like that because they wake us up and they teach us. You know, doesn't the Lord say to thank him for everything? Have you ever been in a place where you had to thank God? Lord, thank you that I just fell on my face right there. My spirit wasn't right. But it brings me back to a realization that I cannot do this in myself, Lord. I need you to live in me. I need to experience a measure of your salvation in this moment, in this circumstance. You know, another bird that we contend with a lot is weariness. And we think we shouldn't have to deal with something like that. After all, he's our strength. But we got to go to him. We got to learn to trust him. You know, I was thinking about how Paul went through his life and he talked about some of his experiences and, you know, being in dangers and so many different places and dangers from robbers. But he talked about weariness, being in places of where he was just really spent. You know, we have to go through things like that to learn in reality that God is faithful, that God can bring us through. How do we learn whether God can deliver us in all kinds of circumstances unless we experience those circumstances? We learn something about God that builds our faith. And I'll tell you what, Abram came out of this a whole lot, like I said, a whole lot better, didn't he? He had to beat the birds off and be true to wait on God. But when he came through it, he was where he needed to be. But you think about the ultimate example, and this is really where it comes back to the Savior. The ultimate example of somebody whose life was spent beating off birds and being the focus of Satan's attention on the earth, it was our Savior. He didn't come to this world to do his own will, did he? And the body that he had been given to him was, it was not just the sacrifice of the cross, was it? The literal laying down of his body in death. It was taking up his cross daily. It was saying, Father, this body that you've given me is yours. Live in me. Do your thing in the world. Speak to people. Act in such a way that you can communicate with people through this body. I give it to you. Oh, did the devil attack that? He went out in the wilderness, and at his weakest point, the birds came, didn't they? If you be the Son of God, command that these stones be made bread. And he stood his ground, and he said, it's written, man shall not live by bread only, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. So that bird went back and said, well, that didn't work. Let's see, let's have a conference here among the birds. And so they sent back another one, and you know, one after another, if you're the Son of God, cast yourself down, carried him up to the high point of the temple. You want to prove once and for all who you are, cast yourself down before everybody. Let's just show off who you are. And obviously that was not the appropriate way to do that. And he said, you don't put God to a foolish test. And right now, the other one has left my mind. But anyway, the birds throughout his ministry, there was this attack of the enemy upon his mind. We have no idea. I know we have the one scripture in Hebrews where it talks about him was enduring with strong crying and tears. He had to seek God many times. There were weariness, there were attacks, the burden of what he had been given. Because he was a man. He had a human frame just like we do. Completely dependent upon his Father to do what he did. Oh, he had to go to his Father, strong crying and tears. Lord, give me what it takes. Help me. I belong to you. The devils are, the birds have come in and they are attacking. They're doing everything in their power to turn me aside. But my heart is fixed. I see beyond. I see your purpose, and that's what I want to be a part of. Thank God that he did that. That's the only reason we can be here today. It's the only reason you and I can have hope is that he stood the test just like the same way Abraham did. So praise God. I don't know. I think I'm going to just, I think this is enough of this, and I just want to leave you with this thought. If you're going to serve God in this world, the birds will come. Don't you be dismayed when they do. Don't you give in to the thoughts that, hey, the Lord's not coming. The Lord's not coming because you're not measuring up, because of this, because of that or the other. All these doubtful thoughts that want to come in. All these things that would turn you aside or turn you to the right or to the left. I'll tell you, we serve a God who is faithful. We serve a God who will honor those who stand fast and say, Lord, I want you, and I'm willing to stand against every bird that flies in my face and tries to steal the sacrifice that belongs to you. I'm yours, and I'm trusting you with everything that I have and everything that I am. I just praise God because I need this, and maybe you don't, but I do. We live in a world where birds are attacking all the time, and I sense it. I saw it in my own life this week, just you get weary sometimes. And you just quit fighting and you quit pushing and you give in to it too easy. And all of a sudden you become self-indulgent and, you know, one thing leads to another. That's not your weakness, but if we're not careful, if we're not watchful, this sacrifice that we have offered to him, the devil will come in and begin to pick it and feed on it. It doesn't belong to him. It belongs to the one who gave up everything for me on that cross. He didn't hold one single thing back that I need. And I'll tell you the same commitment. He is able within me to enable me to make that same kind of a commitment. I don't have it. You leave me to my own resources, I'm going to go the way of the flesh every time. But I'll tell you, there's another one. There's one that, I'll tell you, we give him our heart. We give him our life. We invite him to come in as resident Lord and take over. That doesn't end our battles, but it gives us one who is in us who is greater than everything that would come against us from the outside. Oh, I'll tell you, the one who gave up everything for me comes to live in me. Oh, what a glorious thing it is. What an awesome thing it's going to be to stand there one day and look back and realize everything he said was true. Even when we went through those lonely times, those doubtful times, when the feelings weren't there, we were looking for this and it came from this way. We try to figure our way. This is how God's going to do this. This is how God's going to do that. And he doesn't meet our expectations. And we give in to self-pity and resentment of somebody else that we think's being blessed. And 1,001 expressions of human nature. I don't want that. I want to just be set free. I want to be conscious of these birds so I can be like Abram and beat them off and say, devil, get out of here. You're not part of this scene. I belong to him, and I'm going to wait on him and his time and his way, and that's good enough for me. That was good enough for my Savior. That's good enough for me. Because my God is faithful. He will do what he has promised. Praise God. Praise the Lord. Maybe somebody has something that they can add to this, or we'll just see what the Lord has. Praise the Lord.